Greetings, everyone. Peter Maravelis here on behalf of City Lights booksellers and publishers and the City Lights Foundation. I'd like to welcome you to another installment of City Lights Live, our online event series. As always, we are beaming to you from the unceded ancestral grounds of the Ramatishalone peoples. We'd like to take this moment to acknowledge those who have come before us as stewards of the land. Tonight on City Lights Live, we are featuring a special program that has a great deal of resonance with us here at the store. We are delighted to be co-sponsoring together with Label Curatorial this evening's event. It is titled Generating Future Forms, Bay Convergences of Art and Music, 1958 to 1972. We are celebrating the publication of an important new book. It is titled Dilexi, A Gallery and Beyond. Is by Laura Whitcomb with forewords by Peter Frank and Jim Newman. It is published by Label Curatorial and is the result of 8 years of research by Label Curatorial's director, Laura Whitcomb, and their research director, Narin Dickerson. The book presents the first accurate timeline of the seminal Dilexi Gallery, founded in 1958 by Jim Newman and Robert Alexander. The Dilexi Gallery exhibited the works of some mid-century artists as Jeremy Anderson, Hassel Smith, Leslie Kerr, Jay DeFeo, Ed Moses, Jess, amongst others. The gallery was at the nexus of California's mid-century art scene, and I might add, it was located just down the street from City Lights on Broadway near Kearney. So this program is in many respects about connections, about the threads that connected art, music, literature together in the Bay Area and beyond. Dilexi, A Gallery and Beyond also offers the first accurate accounts of several lesser-known artists, all of whom were key participants in the California art scene and who've been overlooked through time. The book goes beyond documenting the gallery alone and ventures into the film, video, and music programming projects, which extended the gallery's ethos and vision. Central to the narrative of the book is the importance of convergences happening between 1958 to 1972, between contemporary art and experimental music. These convergences in San Francisco was proved to be a key inceptive root of the art and music of the late 60s and the currents of minimalism and conceptualism that followed. So our evening's program will be organized into four parts. Laura Whitcomb and Narin Dickerson will open with a brief introduction, which will be followed by a special video screening of footage prepared especially for this evening. This will be followed by a conversation between myself, Laura, and Narin. We are also extremely honored to have Jim Newman with us tonight as well. So we hope to really bring the rest of you into the discussion towards the very end in a Q&A. So please post your questions, your comments, your praise in the chat function of your Zoom dashboard. I'll also be posting the links with which you may purchase copies of Dilexi, A Gallery and Beyond. And I'd like to point out that this is a limited edition. Although the price point of the book is far greater than most titles we feature, the content was really important enough for us here at City Lights to really promote this book. We feel it's an essential work for those who may have an interest in the mid-century art scene and the history of art in California in particular. So we believe that once you behold the book, you'll really understand its rarity and its importance as much as we do. So I'd like to say a few words about Laura before we begin. She's the curator and art historian at Label Curatorial. She has curated exhibits for a long list of influential artists, which include Ruth Asawa, Jean-Michel Basquiat, Wallace Berman, Bruce Conner, Beatrice Wood, amongst many others. She's produced exhibitions that have focused on the convergence of fine art and music. She has also curated photography exhibitions that have included the work of Gene Clemmer, Robert Mapplethorpe, amongst many others. Ms. Whitcomb has explored the history of contemporary art in California with a particular focus on the impact of Dada and Surrealism, which were key to the gestation of abstract expressionism and the light and space movement, as well as funk and California conceptualism. Through Label Curatorial, Laura has developed exhibitions, catalogs, auxiliary programming, site-specific works, and much, much more. She specializes in bringing together field experts internationally throughout a network of scholarly alliances while consulting the curatorial's own research archive, which has been amassed over a 30-year period. Label Curatorial's most recent exhibition was at the Center for Arts at Eagle Rock. It was titled Tertium Organum, Traversing Space, which is the first installment of the two-part exhibition titled Mysticism and Mathematics. So please join us now in giving a warm welcome to Laura Whitcomb and Narin Dickerson, the Research Director for Label Curatorial. Delighted to have you with us. Welcome to City Lights.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you for that generous introduction. This is such a particular pleasure to have tonight, because the publication Dilexi, A Gallery and Beyond has limitations. And this story really is about Jim Newman, who as a musician had established concerts before he had established the Dilexi Gallery. And so many of his projects have been based on music and film and documentaries. And this is just a wonderful opportunity to present to the public what these look like. We did a retrospective with five galleries in 2019 here in California. The Landing was able to show some of the Dilexi Foundation films, but I think this is a very special opportunity because we will be showing small clips of all of the Dilexi films. And we will also have the opportunity to show a bit of the documentary that Jim Newman did with William Farley on Pandit Pranath, as well as exploring Spaces the Place, which we really didn't get a chance to do during the exhibition, although it was performed here in Los Angeles and San Francisco. And The film is still, you know, a work in progress, and we are very hopeful that there are micro pockets that can become documentaries to themselves one day. And I'd also just quickly like to say that, being that this this symposium, this conversation is based on the idea of music converging with art, we brought in the San Francisco Tate Music Center, and one of the founders, Morton Subotnick, who is on the back of the book here, had generously contributed some interviews with his co-founder, Ramon Sender. And although we don't get to dive too much into the San Francisco Tate Music Center, there are a few clips to sort of, like, you know, whet your appetite, because we are very hopeful to explore that further. I would also like to say that Narin Dickerson has been the research director of this project, and it has been an absolute pleasure to work with him, and he will be speaking shortly after me. But I am just honored to work on the very intriguing task of documenting Jim Newman, because I don't think there is anyone I have ever come across that represents this convergence of art and music more than what he has achieved in his lifetime. So I hope this opportunity to present so many different dynamics of the project might encourage future scholarship. And with that, I will go to Narin Dickerson.
Hello, I just have a quick prepared remark here. One second. Expanding upon the stories of the central characters, which provided the backbone of the story told in this book, Laura and I were both interested in a few paths of exploration for research. To form an accurate and complete chronology of Dilexi over the course of about 11 years at three locations in San Francisco, as well as one in Los Angeles, to learn and share more about the central artists who had not been written about recently. And also, this was very important to both of us, to explore the breadth of all the artists whose work had, by all accounts, been very caringly selected for the gallery's many group shows. The gallery could thus offer a lens to view a portion of a whole milieu of artists working and or showing in the Bay Area who were concerned with creating visionary and meaningful work, and who frequently interacted with each other in ways that helped create a vibrant scene inside and outside the gallery. And we'll talk about some examples after we show the film. But I think the film goes a lot into the interactions between the artists who showed at the gallery and the music and film scene and poetry scene that were going on simultaneously in San Francisco and the rest of the Bay Area. And do you have anything else you'd like to say before we go into the film, Laura, about the film? I think we're about ready to go into the film. We'd like to thank all of the artists' estates, the artists and the galleries for providing a huge amount of images, a huge amount of archives, contributed a huge amount to all the material that you can see in the book if you get yourself a copy, and the material that you'll see in this short, about half hour long film that we'll show you that includes recent interviews conducted over the last few days, as well as archival materials that Laura and I have collected over the past several years.
We can communicate, but what is there to say? We used to assemble in buildings to learn about the other members of society. Then there became many, and we could not meet to learn about lifestyles. We began to meet in books, on the radio, in films, on the television. Now we can meet again on the earth as below, through our media. We can meet metaphysically through the use of this screen. The images are part of the same process. You are looking at electromagnetic waves of the Earth while standing on it. Haven't we met before?
The 1950s in San Francisco was ground zero for a counterculture that would eventually alter American life. Artists, poets, filmmakers, dancers, and performers, recognizing a like-minded will to liberate culture from the blinding impositions of the status quo, collaborated, sharing an interchange of ideas that would impact the future oeuvre of California and beyond.
Gestural and abstract art found a commensurate expression among a new generation of poets and the soundtrack of jazz. This zeitgeist of jazz open portals for a new way of seeing that would soon culminate in a collective yearning for a new way of life. Signaled by the poet visionary Allen Ginsberg when he read his incendiary howl in an art gallery called The Six. The gallery was run by a collective of artists who, along with the poets who read that night, Michael McClure, Philip Lamantia, Philip Whalen, and Gary Snyder, saw themselves subsumed in what soon became known as the Beat Era canon.
The poet and publisher Lawrence Ferlinghetti attended that night and would publish Howl for City Lights Publishing in North Beach. The show was organized and attended by many artists who would later become the fixtures of the Dilexi, a gallery which was encouraged to open when the Sixth Gallery closed. Just around the corner from City Lights, Dilexi opened upstairs from the Jazz Workshop, one of North Beach's most notable venues for music. Dilexi, meaning to covet and to love, would have a constant soundtrack of some of the Bay Area's most notable musicians. The decision to open a gallery above a jazz venue was key. The gallery, established by jazz musician and programmer Jim Newman and the artist and poet Bob Alexander, would offer a space where the groundbreaking directions of music and art would be housed under one roof. Newman had been part of the Sindel Studio, which organized the first showing of Bay Area abstract artists in Southern California, which was hoisted upon a merry-go-round at the Santa Monica Pier. The Dilexi had ties to Los Angeles, where Alexander Newman's close friend, Walter Hopps, had established the Ferris Gallery. Newman, who had been a silent partner in Ferris, would share a program with Walter Hopps that would catalyze the art scene in both cities. Dilexi endured as a gallery from 1958 to 1969, And throughout its time, Newman, a musician and programmer, would offer the public one of its most powerful convergences. Its first year showcased two generations of abex and gestural painters, a scene that was beginning to gain national attention. Many of these painters saw the canvas as a catalyst to overcome the traumas of war, while collectively they often saw their work as a complementary ethos and soundtrack to the revolution of jazz. Many of these artists who had their debuts at Dilexi would become world-renowned, and the book documents unknown chapters of their gestations in San Francisco. Dilexi, a gallery and beyond, pushes further and chronicles many artists that have been lost to the record. Outside of J. DeFeo, whose The Eyes grace its cover, the book chronicles many artists for the first time, lesser-known women of abstract expressionism, Lois Lazarus and Irene Taverner, while highlighting Sonia Getthoff and Deborah Remington in their early careers.
We regard Dilexi as the quintessential San Francisco gallery, founded on an idealistic sense of newness, innovation, and experimentation, and, perhaps as a result, establishing itself as the liveliest place in town for contemporary art, especially local art. But this very formula mirrors that of adventurous galleries around the Western world at the same time. Places like Betty Parsons or Green Gallery in New York, Studio Marconi in Milan, Robert Fraser or Signal in London, Conrad Fischer in Düsseldorf, and of course Ferris in Los Angeles. These galleries are programmed by their owners, whether artists or otherwise, and manifested singular visions even while displaying a variety of styles. Indeed, one of Dilexi's hallmarks was its eclecticism. Jim Newman's roster included, among others, abstract expressionists, junk sculptors, geometric painters, proto-funk parasurrealists, and even the occasional figurative artist. We think of the 1960s as the prelude to a postmodernist plurality, but outside New York, at least, it was already the beginning. The West Coast art scenes were by and large unburdened by dogma or hierarchy, and the range of styles, methods, genres, and materials found at Dilexi in any given season reflected not only the expansive taste of its founder, but the laissez-faire aesthetics of a discourse by and large removed
the Dilexi
from the
also
dictates
began
of an
showing
international
artists
art
who were
market.
Exploring conceptualism, minimalism, and what would later become known as light and space. Over its years, Dilexi's curatorial mission questioned established modalities, seeking a confrontation with the unknown, the unexplored, and at times the convulsive, to shock us into a new way of seeing. The diverse program often at times appeared conflicting, however, as a collective whole, it offered a powerful new voice, rattling convention, seeking a new clarity and deeper purpose. Newman, as both a musician and music curator, would play a pivotal role among his art program, but would soon find a new soundtrack with the revolutionary new music, embracing the new electronic technology coming out of the Bay and the local San Francisco Tape Music Center. These directions of Bay Area artists were matched with a new soundtrack through the radical establishment of the SFTMC, which was founded by musicians Morton Subotnick, Ramon Sender, and later Pauline Oliveros.
And one night I was playing the Mozart Clarinet Concerto with the Marin Symphony Orchestra. And at the end of the concert, one of the French horn players came up to me and said, "Can I get a ride back to San Francisco with you?" And I said, "Sure." And as we drove, we talked, and we talked about poets we knew and music we were writing. And that person was Pauline Oliveros. She knew Robert Duncan, and I knew Michael McClure, and we were doing this whole thing. And so then she got me invited to go to the seminar, the Erickson seminar, and bring some of my music and get it played by a pianist. And so I came, and that's when I met Ramon. And the three of us became the Three Musketeers, you know, and I joined them the second year. I think it went for 2 years. I joined them the last year, let's put it that way. I don't know which one it was.
They fused concrete and electronic music and developed with engineer Don Buchla a synthesizer that would revolutionize the West Coast sound. They collaborated with the dance practitioner Anna Halperin, who had already been working with experimental composers Warner Jepson, Bill Spencer, Lamont Young, and Terry Riley. Riley notably premiered his In C at the SFTMC, and along with Lamont Young's drone music, launched a new era of minimalist music.
We were beginning to think like we'd like to have some visuals in the ongoing program, and since Mort had been working with it, and we approached her dancers and said, would you like to participate in these events? And they said yes. So we had them in, and it was they were fantastic. They just added a lot to those shows.
For instance, in Parades and Changes, we really collaborated on these pieces. And so the Parades and Changes, the paper dance, the ripping and the tearing and all this was amplified, and that was the music.
The San Francisco Tate Music Center sought out like-minded radical new media to offer visually immersive experiences for their spearheading new sound. The Dilexi artist Elias Romero, who had hosted light shows mixing oils and inks at the gallery, became the SFTMC's first light artist, synchronizing their new sound to the color spectrum of light, which was followed by another light artist, Tony Martin. The SFTMC also presented performances by the poet Robert Duncan and his partner Jess, who notably had his first gallery show at Dilexi and showcased his collages on its walls. The San Francisco Tate Music Center also worked with the lesser-known seminal practitioner of the happening and action theater movements, Ken Dewey. The publication documents his seminal influence, tying the worlds of experimental music, activism, action theater, and Anna Halperin, who he had studied and collaborated with, highlighting the interconnections of artists that would be key influences on the East Coast.
Later, Dewey's Dilexi film would enlist Bill Spencer, who along with Warner Jepson had scored Halperin's early performances. Dewey was a key director on the SFTMC's City Scale, which saw the city of San Francisco become a canvas for action theater and happenings throughout the city. It was an ideal opportunity to explore the endemic humor of the Bay Area, deconstructing the psychic hold of its status quo. One of the City Scale events took passengers to see an opera singer performing in a laundromat, a car ballet in North Beach, Halperin's dancers staging an absurdist street argument, followed by a happening that encouraged the return of all stolen books to city lights. This community joined the merry prankster Ken Kesey and the visionary Stuart Brand to create the Trips Festival in 1966. Inspired by the acid test parties held the prior year, this event sought to cross-pollinate the zeitgeist of like-minded visionaries into one of the most important events to catalyze the first being and summer of love. Music from the Grateful Dead, Big Brother and the Holding Company, and the Jefferson Airplane inaugurated this first immersive psychedelicized gathering. Dilexi artist and light pioneer Elias Romero joined Bill Hamm and Tony Martin to create abstract light shows of floating globular forms in emulsion, which were timed to the sounds of Buchla's sound light console. They joined the dancers' workshop in Canyon Cinema, showing the experimental films of Bruce Bailey and others, along with the Dilexi shown artist Charles McDermott, who assisted launching new sound.
San Francisco, basking in post-war Bohemia, was a devoted jazz town and had also become a center for experimental music and film. Newman took full advantage of all the talent in the neighborhood. Screenings, ensemble performances, readings, and other presentations amplified the Dilexi profile. Newman was not blazing trails here, but continuing the example of scruffier beat loci such as the Six and Batman. He was simply ramping up the ambitiousness of the programming itself.
San Francisco at this time was an epicenter of interdisciplinary cross-pollination, largely ushered by the dance practitioner Anna Halperin and her dancers' workshop, who shared space and collaborated with the composers of the SFTMC, as well as the actors' workshop and the experimental Canyon Cinema, offering an environment of cross-pollination that Newman exported into the gallery.
In 1965, the artist Charles Ross, who had been working with Halprin and the San Francisco Tape Music Center's founder-composer Morton Subotnick, presented a collaboration with the Dancers' Workshop at Dilexi.
The enduring Dilexi story portrays the importance of the real-time experience of art within the gallery setting, presenting how this intimate encounter may collectively congeal a new way of seeing and distill a philosophy for a new way of life.
I was living in Fresno in 1966, but I attended experimental events in San Francisco at the Dancers' Workshop whenever possible, and spent a lot of time in City Lights buying experimental poetry magazines. I moved to San Francisco in 1967, but in May of 1968, I produced a concert of my music at the Dancers' Workshop, attended by Ann and Larry Halprin. Larry was writing a book on scores called the RSVP Cycles, and he immediately asked for copies of the scores that I was performing with my colleague Ted Greer. We used drawings as sort of stimulus to have us perform on a variety of instruments laid out on tables, and very few of them were actually musical instruments. But we made sounds with them, and it was almost Dadaesque in its exhibitionism. 1969, I worked on A Ceremony of Us with Anna Halprin, and Jim Newman, of course, was a sponsor of that. And I met Liam O'Gallagher, the painter and conceptual artist, who was attending all of the workshops between the dancers from Watts and the dancers from Marin County. Liam encouraged me to record their conversations and their interactions, and then he worked with me to produce a disc for the Dilexi Foundation of the audio of these conversations that was also used during the performance at the opening of the Mark Taper Forum in Los Angeles. On July 8, 1969, I was hired to work as the music director at KPFA Radio and started a series of radio events in which the medium of radio was used very differently. The idea was to get artists to make pieces of any length and have the audience on the radio, listening to the radio, take some physical action. And she did a very funny thing, which was to have the audience rearrange their furniture in time to music, and she ended with circus music that was raucous. People would call in and say, "Oh, I've destroyed my living room." And it was a wonderful use of radio in the tradition of Jim's use of television.
The cross-pollination of Dilexi's extended network through the Dancers' Workshop and the SFTMC would later transform the East Coast through the experiments at Judson Dance Theater and the Fluxus and Minimalist art movements.
This impact is best represented through the series of films Newman's Dilexi Foundation would commission for television on KQED. Spurred by the philosophies of Marshall McLuhan's concept, the medium is the message, Newman commissioned films from Terry Riley, Yvonne Rainer, Anna Halprin, Walter DeMaria, as well as Julian Beck of the Living Theater.
To assault the culture, to assault you, to assault ourselves, and to establish the facts and the feeling of where we are right now.
If we continue to have a coercive structure controlling us, we now know that coercive structures always and inevitably degenerate into tyrannical, rigid fascist structures.
One of the most notable Dilexi films representing the convergence of art and music was made by Terry Riley and Arlo Acton, who created sound speaker sculptures that swayed like pendulums to microtonal music.
Newman traveled to the Factory in New York to enlist Andy Warhol, acquiring the film Paul Swan. Another New York artist was Ed Schlossberg, while further local Bay Area talent included Dilexi artist Phil McConaughey and filmmaker Robert Nelson with artist William Wiley. He also enlisted Robert Frank for the Dilexi films for KQED television, who 10 years before had directed Pull My Daisy, considered to be the most notable Beat Era film. Narrated by Jack Kerouac, it starred Ginsberg, Gregory Corso, and French feminist actress Delphine Seyrig. The cult of humor was furthered by a film directed by Frank Zappa.
In 1970, Newman commissioned the Dilexi Gallery hard-edge artist Phil McKenna to direct Shoot the Whale. McKenna envisioned the film to be an extended abstract expressionist painting, and it broke new terrain using members of the Bay Area Action Theater. This cowboy circus, World War II, electronic musical comedy, which Steve Seid called a delirious pageant about violence and decline of the West, starred Daryl Enriquez and the East Bay Sharks, an early 70s street theater troupe known for the surreal strain of absurdism, which would be a thorough line with Dilexi.
The film would see a soundtrack created by two experimental composers, Robert Ashley and Blue Jean Tierney. Ashley was known for his operas using extended techniques and pioneering usage of electronics. Tierney had notably worked with Iggy Pop and the Stooges, Laurie Anderson and John Cage. Together, they created a soundtrack which they intended to never be noticed, echoing the lyricism of each scene.
More notably, Newman went on to produce the film Space is the Place. Here, Dilexi's license to enact an ideology into the very fabric of a film merged social activism with a creative license. Sun Ra's cosmology formed the backbone of the Afrofuturist movement.
The thing about Space is the Place is that it's hard to know what to do with it. It's to see how it fits together. It's part documentary, it's part science fiction, some black exploitation there, elements of even early art films like Maya Deren's Meshes in the Afternoon with their mirror face figures. Ra had seen some of those films when he played between them and Jonas Mekas' shows at the Charles Theater in New York. It seems to me like there's some Roger Corman there, maybe 42nd Street, the 1933 film, which is about how a performance is being subverted and blocked. Certainly Henry Jacobs' Vortex Light shows with abstract music in the same planetarium in San Francisco in the mid-50s. And certainly part biblical epic. Sun Ra's genius was to treat the Bible as if it was science fiction. The film was made, Sun Ra said that Star Wars and Close Encounters of the Third Kind had ripped elements of his film off. And it's certainly clear to me that there's a parallel to his composition, Lights on a Satellite, which in 1960 does seem to be echoed in the spaceship in Close Encounters. And I can also mention that when a friend of mine saw him coming out of the theater after seeing Star Wars and asking what he thought, he said, it's true to life. At the time, while I was reading the Urantia book, a volume that had been channeled to Earth, it was about 2,000 pages long, and I've never seen it myself because he kept giving the parts away, where he would hand a person 8 or 9 pages and then go somewhere else and hand it to someone else, and something like how he treated songs as well. He would sometimes go in and out rapidly without finishing the material. In the book, it's predicted that a celestial musician would lead the way to straightening Earth out. And at the same time, composer Karlheinz Stockhausen was reading that same book, and it's the basis for his week-long composition, Light. It's fair to ask you, is there any relevance to this film today, 50 years later? And I think so. At one level, the dominance of music in a film without it actually becoming a musical is something you can learn from. It floods what's happening, and yet somehow the narrative unfolds.
How do you know I'm real?
Yeah.
I'm not real. I'm just like you. You don't exist in this society. If you did, your people wouldn't be seeking equal rights. You're not real. If you were, you'd have some status among the nations of the world. So we're both myths. I do not come to you as a reality. I come to you as the myth, because that's what black people are, myths. I came from a dream that the black man dreamed long ago. I'm actually a present sent to you by your ancestors.
Space is the Place featured some of the designs of the Ant Farm Group, an underground architectural, graphic arts, and environmental design practice, originally founded by Chip Lord and Doug Michaels. Two of its founders met in an architectural workshop directed by Lawrence Halprin, and later Ant Farm would be joined by Hudson Marquez and Curtis Schreier. Newman was introduced to them through Walter Hopps, beginning a long-standing friendship that resulted in the console featured in Space is the Place, while he participated in their notable performance spectacles.
In 1968, there was revolution in the air. There was a student movement that was transcended the U.S., and nobody in my graduating class really wanted to go and work in a corporate office building. After all, the Bank of America and Chula Vista had just been burned down as a protest against the Vietnam War. So we decided to found an alternative architecture practice. An underground architecture practice is how we described it to a friend, and she immediately said, like the ant farm I had when I was a kid.
First we did a architectural project for Jim on his house to make a squash court into a kind of screening room with a projection booth. And Curtis designed the projection booth and spent a year building it, custom making the entire, shaped components. This was eventually used in the as a control center for Sun Ra in the film that Jim produced a few years later. Curtis, I think, also designed the poster for the Sun Ra movie. I came to San Francisco in 1968 for the Halprin workshop with Ann and Larry Halprin and Paul Baum. And afterwards, Doug Michaels joined me. I'd met him a year earlier. And we decided we're gonna create a new studio practice, architecture, and underground architecture. And a friend said, oh, like Ant Farm, that's underground architecture. And we met Jim shortly thereafter in the fall of 1968. We left to go to Houston and to do some teaching there. And when we came back in, it was spring of 1973, Jim became involved with several projects that we did over the next few years. And the companion piece to Media Burn was the Eternal Frame project we did with T.R. Uthko about a month or 6 weeks after Media Burn. We all went down, we took a crew to Dallas to do the filming. And Jim had a Super 8 camera. He shot footage, and eventually we gathered different footage and video and put together a video artwork of the Kennedy the reenactment of the Kennedy assassination.
D-
Documentaries under Newman's production, collaborating with William Farley, investigated the deeper underpinnings of minimalist composers, focusing upon Pandit Pran Nath and his influence on Lamont Young, Marian Zazila, and Terry Riley, presented the reciprocity between Eastern philosophy and the Western electronic exploration.
The first thing in hearing him sing, you can't help but be very deeply moved and feel like you've come in contact with a very old soul, something that's very ancient and what people associate with the ancient wisdom of India, the Vedas, the Puranas, these texts. And of course that attracted me on an abstract level. And even though I was considered an accomplished musician in Western classical music, I had not really the ability, the hearing ability to grasp at that time what he was really doing, except that I was moved by the sound. I didn't know what it was within the sound that was actually moving me till after I'd studied with him for a while. And even now, I've been with Guruji for 15 years, and I still feel like it's trying to, when he sings and we try to copy what he does, it's like trying to copy smoke. It's no shape and it's every shape.
By the late 1960s, many people in the West had begun to look to the ancient Eastern cultures for sources of both spiritual and aesthetic inspiration. The avant-garde American composers, Terry Riley and Lamont Young, had long been attracted to the sound of Indian classical music. In 1967, Young and his wife, the artist Marian Zazila, heard a tape of the singing of Pandit Pran Nath and were deeply moved. In 1970, they arranged for him to make his first trip to the West to perform his music.
So you see studying Indian music as adding just another possibility to your language as a composer?
Well, it added a very big possibility. I mean, it covers... Look at the scalic possibilities. In Western music, we essentially have major and minor modes. We essentially have 3-4 and 4-4. And we learned to do all our music this way through ingenious combinations of ensembles and building up form and drama in the music. And we get a great variety of our music. But out of these very simple elements, if you look at most Western music, that's what it's made out of. Marches and waltzes and major and minor. Indian music has galaxies of scales and raga melodies built on these scales, just innumerable rhythmic combinations and patterns and ways of putting these rhythms together. So if you begin studying it, your vocabulary of just what's called swara and tala, the melodic and rhythmic elements, starts growing by leaps and bounds.
The Dilexi ethos questioned the status quo, highlighting how the abstract and the experimental offered key messages to recalibrate culture. The Dilexi legacy to champion the convergence of art and music continued with the establishment of the alternative music program organization Other Minds, established with the composer and notable Bay Area radio programmer Charles Amerkanian. Many of the composers who launched their career through the Tape Center are notable Bay Area musicians in Other Minds' repertoire that continue the program of both Dilexi and the Halprin legacy.
Subsequently, in November of 92, I announced I was leaving KPFA with my wife, Carol Law. Jim telephoned me and asked me, is there any way he can keep me involved in music activities in San Francisco?
That's when we started talking about we should be doing something for new music, because there wasn't that much going on here. In the year preceding the first festival, John Cage, who was a great inspiration to all of us, passed on.
And he had a very dismissive, unsigned obituary in the New Yorker.
Said that John Cage could have been thought to have composed music in other people's minds. And so the idea of Other Minds, it just seemed to connect. And so that's when the first Other Minds Festival began. We had the Kronos Quartet. We had Phil Glass from New York, John Jang.
Some older people, some younger people, always an emphasis on female composers, people of color.
As far as I'm concerned, we need to listen to everything. Every sound is some form of intelligence and information.
This book presents a gallery as a place beyond the presentation of art, a place to champion a new ethos, an ideology which eventually may be parlayed into a new mediums of presentation and new modalities of expression. This book documents how this Dilexi ethos evolved beyond the gallery's walls and eventually transformed into an interdisciplinary approach expressing itself through a multitude of new media. Meanwhile, the art shown at Dilexi has left its DNA all over the art world. And as this event attests, there is a renewed interest by artists and others in what that art was and what it meant at the time of its realization and exposure. The grandchildren, as usual, are fascinated by the artifacts of their ancestors. But can the art world and the world in general give today's artists the room and support they need to make their own Dilexi? Or is the moment lost and the renewed interest is a regretful goodbye to all that? No, we have to come to visit Dilexi, not to revise it. To imitate it is futile. To emulate is noble. And to remember is enough.
Wow, that felt like a very substantial meal. Just amazing. I want to invite now Laura, Narin, and Jim Newman to join us. So much going on in that film. And you know, I think that it makes a lot of sense in some ways to, well, first, I want to congratulate you. I mean, this was such an ambitious and really beautifully produced project and book. I mean, it's a sight to behold. And I think that the film, you know, really shows it beautifully, just in preserving the memory of just numerous seminal artists and also these important moments in Bay Area art history. I mean, I think Dilexi speaks to us on many levels here at City Lights. And as mentioned earlier, I felt that there are so many threads that come together on this project, you know, like Dilexi, like City Lights, was one amongst many hubs that connected art, film, music, literature together. I think with the loss of the San Francisco Art Institute, which was another great hub, I think many of us feel this kind of urgency now to kind of document many of the stories and the histories that are kind of highlighted in this book. I think Dilexi can be seen as a kind of a artistic portal through which collective energies of many different artists came to mature and develop. And I think maybe we can begin by talking about the importance of place in all of this.
In regards to place, we are in California and we have this incredible tradition, the indigenous tradition of the gathering. And that idea is this convergence of different artistic expressions. And when song and dance and art and costume all combine, and each one shares a like-minded message through a different varied expression, there's almost this capacity of a neuroplasticity to really create a powerful paradigmatic change within culture. In view of that being the precedent, the historical precedent for California to move forward from, I think San Francisco in the post-war era offered this incredible opportunity that really encouraged this convergence of the poets and the artists and the filmmakers and the dancers. And I don't think there's any place like that in the world that really was saw a young community organizing venues and alternative spaces, largely artist and poet run. And I think San Francisco really offered something that nowhere in the country it wasn't happening. Arguably it was happening in New York, but not to the extent where there was a like-minded ethos that was encouraged to be expressed in other media.
Jim, would you like to kind of chime in since, well, you were there at Ground Zero?
I guess it was Ground Zero. My Ground Zero was started at Stanford in 1950 when I met Walter. We called him Chico Hops, and at that time, and we were on a path of presenting mostly jazz music in concert, which I did at Oberlin with Dave Brubeck, and he did in a number of occasions, or we did together in LA. And I came to San Francisco in 1956 and met a bunch of visual artists that were inspiring. San Francisco at that time, I think, was at, along with New York, were at the peak of experimentation and innovation in the visual arts. And so that led to my opening the gallery in 1958 with Bob Alexander, who left after a year. But I stayed with it for an extended time until I kind of burned out on it. But those were great days. Nothing like today. Today, there's an emphasis on money and collecting and all of that, which was sort of very peripheral to my experience back then. I was always on the lookout for new people with new forms of expression and new ideas. And that's when I met Ant Farm and Chip and those people. Because they represented that to me and all the many artists that I worked with in those days.
And I know that Lawrence Ferlinghetti would visit the Dilexi, and yeah. He was, really interested in alternative spaces. Because, oftentimes, he would hear, I'd hear him talking about, the East West, the Six, the Dilexi, oh. And so on, and the importance, because, he always thought of City Lights as being, he felt it was really, really important to be able to create a kind of a third space where people felt comfortable, where they could just sort of let loose and kind of take in information and share with each other. And I feel like Dilexi is very much in that spirit.
Well, he was very much at the center of things, as was Anna Halperin, of course, whom I presented in my gallery on one occasion and would attend her performances. And it was largely through her that I met the musicians that I came to work with, including Charles Amrakanian and Terry Riley and others. And so that opened up a whole new avenue of involvement for me, which was very important, which became increasingly important after I closed the gallery and still is to this day. Mm-hmm. What can I say?
I want to talk a little bit about, I mean, there was such a massive amount of research that went into this book. And I'm very interested in how, you know, Narin and Laura, how you went into connecting the dots. I mean, what your methods were. And very importantly, I mean, you've opened up doors for future scholars to kind of expand on your research. Could you also talk about what, you know, what you would suggest to younger scholars who are kind of researching this area?
Narin, do you want to answer that?
For younger scholars coming in, I mean, just find something and explore it, because there's probably a lot more information there that you can delve into. The digital resources that have been made available recently in terms of scanned documents create an ability to search and find resources that you can travel to or may not even need to travel to. I could talk a little bit about the research project, because Laura had been involved previously to getting involved in the Dilexi project with a project researching the art of veterans coming and getting the GI Bill after World War II. And there was that project and an ongoing project that we're both still working on artist run and artist influenced galleries in the Bay Area. And those are both ongoing projects. And Laura had done several interviews related to those before becoming involved in the Dilexi project and continued doing several interviews with a lot of the important central participants of Dilexi Gallery even before I became involved. When I became involved, she'd conducted a number of interviews. She had a number of clippings. She had the announcements from the gallery. And the part that I initially came in with was trying to organize all of those materials, many of which were undated or had been labeled by previous archives with incorrect dates. So it was difficult to sort of juggle those around. So the initial entry into that was organizing the 11 years of gallery shows. Additionally, like researching all of the names of the artists that came up that we hadn't been familiar with. Many of them we were familiar with, but there were many lesser known artists who were central to the gallery, and then many lesser known artists that were featured in group shows. And once we found out more about their names, we wanted to know even more. An example would be the initial opening gallery announcement includes the name Mel Weitzman, who's, if people are familiar with Zen in the Bay Area, is an extremely important part of the Zen community in the Bay Area, and his name appeared as an artist there. This also brings up, you know, uncertainty in research, because neither Mel or Jim remember him being the opening show, but we have a copy of his name on the announcement. So we still are a little uncertain of whether the final appearance at the gallery included his work or not. That may be a mystery lost to time.
That's a very good example of a lot of the challenges that this project brought to the surface. One really important thing that I would advise all researchers moving forward is to be open. A lot of times there's a narrow focus for a thesis, but if you are open to seeing the cross-pollination that's actually happening and the connective tissue between cities, and to just absorb as much as you can and continue with your focus, you will find that there is a greater story. And my whole journey has really been just trusting the signs. And I was led to meet Jim Newman through just a spontaneous meeting and the encouragement to see Raina Branston and who introduced me to Stephen Goldstein, who was the former director of the San Francisco Art Institute. And, you know, after long conversations, he honed in that my curiosity and interest in the Bay Area should merit the introduction to Jim Newman, who was an ideal person to document because there was absolutely no judgment on my lack of knowledge on this period. And it just, I think what's so important for research is on projects like this is to have the capacity to enjoy yourself, to find it, to become something that you're seeking to know about yourself as well. And truly this project has done that for me. I've grown immensely. And I think so many of the participants down the line have experienced such transitions. So I hope that answers the question to encourage other researchers moving forward on territory that hasn't been well documented moving forward.
Thank you for that. Jim, I'd like to talk a little bit about the ethos of curating. And if you were to speak to younger people maybe opening up a gallery now, you know, what was the experience like for you? And what were some of the things that were kind of running through your mind as you were like, you know, working with all these different people and coming into their orbit and being influenced?
It was a long journey of discovery and with surprising events occurring along the way. I still do it. I curate film now, not visual art, but it's very much the same process. You just, and we have the internet, which makes things a lot easier. We didn't have that back then. But anyway, I've discovered so many things this way. And I think, you know, just keeping your mind and your eyes and your ears open to experience, you're going to be surprised and delighted often. And that's what I would suggest to people, you know, embarking on any kind of journey like this, to always be aware of and to stay tuned in.
And I was wondering, you know, I was hoping that maybe you would talk about maybe one of the projects you worked on. And I'm going to be very selfish and ask you to talk about working with Sun Ra and working on Space and the Place and how that kind of came about. Give us a little bit of a feel for what it was like in those times.
Well, like everything else, there's this convergence of different things coming from sources, very disparate, but the place I first encountered Sun Ra was at the San Francisco Art Institute, where a friend invited me to go with him to a Sun Ra concert in their outdoor area, which I did. And that was my first experience of Sun Ra. I'd heard of him, but I didn't know what his music was like. So this was in 68, I think it was. There's still a copy of the poster that they used to advertise to promote that, I think mainly that went to the students. That was that. And then I eventually, I had worked with John Coney at KQED to do the series of film projects. So I said, John, let's do one on Sun Ra. He's incredible. I think you'd love his stuff, and I do. And so we had went through all these ideas. We had the director of photography was Seth Hill, who was an employee of KQED at the time. And he had ideas, and John had ideas, and I had some. And so we approached Sun Ra, and he was open to it. So we worked out a contract with him, which was, looking back, was like for next to nothing. Anyway, he brought his orchestra to San Francisco, and we, in 72, we started working on the film. And it was finally completed in 74. He was an interesting person to work with, an interesting person to listen to. You didn't get too many of your own ideas in there, but his were enough. And so there we have it. It's just became Space is the Place.
Wow.
Looking on the internet, I do searches and I find the most amazing interesting ideas about that film from all over the world, from different people. I was doing that and found very interesting information that I didn't have any idea of.
Holds up. It holds up because there's something mythic about it. Yeah.
Yeah.
May I ask you about Anne Halpern now and, you know, your kind of entrance into that world?
Well, I don't know how to begin there. They were amazing people, Anna and Larry, and what they encouraged and developed here. And so it seemed natural in the, in the later 60s to connect and do something. And we did it. We did one event together. Well, actually more than one. We did as Charles was talking about in the film, the Ceremony of Us, which became Right On, which was part of my film series for KQED. Then the event actually in the gallery, where Charles Ross, who was a very important artist working with me in the middle 60s, who had come out of UC Berkeley as a sculptor, and he somehow got involved with the Dancers Workshop and built things and did participate in their performances. And he had this, I wanted to give him a show, but his idea was to do this show with the Dancers Workshop. And so if you remember those little, there are scenes in the film we saw Charles carrying a tree into the gallery, and we don't see Anna there, but we see some of her performers, and my two-year-old son, Eric, on the floor. Anyway, that was We continued to stay in touch, Anna and I, and I thought she was like a center of very important, great artistic activity all through that period and almost up to the very present. And her daughter and they still carry on, do their work, which is extraordinary.
Well, I was thinking we could open it up for Q&A with the audience. The questions have already started to come in.
I see three chats.
Yeah, so I have one from Robert Marshall. Could Jim please talk about how his experiences at Oberlin College influenced his art and music projects?
Well, after leaving California and going back to school at Oberlin and developing a whole new circle of relationships there, and I had met Dave Brubeck in San Francisco with Grover Sales, who was an art writer here and important person in the Bay Area. So I said, well, let's bring Dave to Oberlin. I think he would do well. We would do well at the concert. Nobody knew about him back then. This was 53, other than people in the Bay Area, pretty much. And it was a huge success. And it produced a record which I still listen to from time to time, Jazz at Oberlin. So that was a central event for me at Oberlin. I can't think of anything else other than individual relationships that I had with people back then that really informed or led to anything that I did later other than that event. It was very important for me in my development. Yeah.
So I have a question from Frank. Jim, could you please identify the painting behind you?
Yes. Oh, you saw that. Good, Frank. That's a painting by Fred Martin. We should talk about Fred Martin, who just passed at the age of 96, maybe. who was a very important and influential artist, at one time head of the school at the Art Institute, but somebody I'd known since the mid-50s, who was showed at the Sixth Gallery and later showed at my gallery, and was important with work that he did with other galleries and with Crown Point Press, Catherine Brown. He did, and he produced something that we featured in a show called Beulah Land, which was part of our summer series of events that Laura put together in 2019. That's the painting behind me. Just painting. It's a great painting.
Let's see. Hank asks, and this I guess could be directed to all of you, how does one fund and keep open a gallery like Dilexi, especially with less of a focus or interest in money, as Jim mentioned earlier?
I don't know if I should answer that.
I think you're going to have to, Jim.
Well, just, you know, by hook or crook, skin of your teeth or whatever, you know, you just carry on day to day. I mean, it was really difficult. There was very little income. I had some money that I could put into it. I was made a director of my family's business back then, where I was paid $200 a month. And so that sort of helped fund the gallery. And I did sell a few things over time.
Looking through the archives and reading through the letters of the, you know, through the years of the galleries, a lot of hard work. A lot of work. Getting the artists out into the world and getting them written about in other places, exposed to other places, and a lot.
Yeah, and if I can add something to that, you know, working at City Lights, you know, it takes a village in the end, and you know, it's not one person, and Lawrence used to say that all the time, is that, you know, it's by the good graces of all of our friends and families that you know, these types of spaces can exist. And sometimes you'll bump into somebody who, just out of the kindness of, or just love of your project or whatever, you know, steps in. And but you know, it's everybody. So I think it, you know, you need to, you know, have a vision though. And Jim, I think that, you know, yourself, Lawrence, I mean, I think that, you know, people who ran these spaces and who continue to kind of, you know, generate, you know, these kinds of spaces have that vision. And I think that's what appeals to people, where they keep coming back, why they're interested in this kind of stuff, is because, you know, there is something about the vision itself that is very appealing, and that creates a kind of a third space where people can enter and, you know, and find wonder.
And the dare to take risk, because that is certainly a massive factor. And I think in Jim's particular case, he's never been concerned what the consensus of the status quo thought. He just was somebody beating his own drum and just trusting his instincts. And I think that's really the merit of his curating, was just this instinctual choice and creating the ontological connections between other instinctual choices he came across, yeah. and just owning it, mm-hmm. literally and figuratively.
Thank you.
Yeah. Let's see. Kathy and Michael are interested in the collaboration between Dilexi and the San Francisco Art Institute, both in their heydays.
Is there anyone who wants to speak for the Art Institute?
I mean, that's a really good question. Jim, I mean, you were often, you know, looking at a lot of the students' works. I know William Dubin had, you had left a message in a hallway that he should get in contact with you. All these, many of your artists, Roger Jacobson, they were all students. And of course, Fred Martin was teaching there. So I think definitely the connective tissue between the Art Institute and Dilexi is very palpable. Many of the early teachers, Hassel Smith was Hassel Smith, who taught at the San Francisco Art Institute when it was called the California School of Fine Arts. He was one of the most often shown artists through the years. So right. there are strong connections between the school and the gallery and City Lights. So so that's a really great question.
Yeah, I probably wouldn't have opened my gallery if it hadn't been for the legacy of the Art Institute and the artists that came through there. Most of the people I worked with had a connection with the Art Institute, much more than say UC, Berkeley. There were some that had gone to school there, but the Art Institute was the primary institution that funneled artists to me. I don't know. I would be there a lot. Went to events there, parties there, screenings there, whatever, and. Certainly, I think the Six Gallery was also important very early on. And they were largely products of the Art Institute, the artists that formed them.
In the accounts of artists, even ones that weren't directly involved as students or teachers at the San Francisco Art Institute, they still describe it as a significant arts hub for them in the Bay Area, just living in proximity to it being important. And the two had, a direct connection at the end of Dilexi as a gallery, when Jim was no longer, was focusing on the Dilexi Foundation rather than the Dilexi Gallery. He gave the gallery space, the remainder of the lease to the San Francisco Art Institute for the curator, Phil Inaris, to curate a few shows at that space before the lease ended.
Yeah.
And we include some of the artists in those books because Phil Inaris recapitulates some of the early artists that showed at Dilexi who were now involved with the San Francisco Art Institute. And showed them at the gallery as well as new emerging artists.
Yeah, and you know, and City Light's connection to the Art Institute has been huge. I mean, we held memorials for the West Coast Memorial for William S. Burroughs. You know, we've worked together with the Kashar brothers. Fred Martin was really close. I mean, you know, he was very generous with us, but it was a communal space for City Lights. I mean, we did a big Wallace Berman weekend once, you know, our Dada World Fair, Walter Benjamin in San Francisco. I mean, the events just go on and on and on. It really was a wonderful communal space. And I think, you know, we're definitely feeling the loss, you know, of that. I mean, I think I can't imagine, you know, with its history and how much impact it had, that you know, the city of San Francisco wouldn't just like step in and say, you know what, we just have to save this. I mean, this is a cultural landmark.
Right.
And truly one of the greatest contributors to scholarship on this period is made through Jeff Gunderson, who was the director of the Ann Bremer Library. So hopefully this project will encourage many to pick up the banner of the Bay Area, because it is so rich in history, and it is such the inceptive roots and the influence it had on American culture, especially as this book reveals on the influence on the East Coast, where so many of the ideas of Fluxus and Judson Theater percolated in the Bay Area, particularly through the Halperins and also Dilexi. These are stories that should continue, but the Art Institute has generously, especially through Jeff Gunderson, guided so many projects from this period of time. So it is a great loss, but hopefully there might be some way to create an endowment for it as a research center, because we truly do not lose an invaluable education center, but a research center to tell this story.
Yeah, that's a great idea. You know, we're coming up to the hour, but I want to talk a little bit about what future projects you're working at Label, and if you'd give us a little hint, maybe a teaser.
Oh my! Wow. Well, we just completed a show about Uspensky and Gurdjieff, and exploring the idea of mysticism and mathematics and how that became an underpinning, a story that has not been well documented, on how that influenced many 20th century artists. It's a part one of a show that's going to explore the golden ratio and how that throughout the timeline of history has been influential on both indigenous art and to this day contemporary art. It interfaces with the idea of the Getty Pacific Standard Time project about exploring art and science. Having said that, there is a show that will be opening in a week at LAX, which is titled The Luminaries of Light and Space. And the artists are Fred Eversley, Robert Irwin, Laddie John Dill, Gisela Colon, Hap Tibby, Peter Alexander, Dwayne Valentine, who also just recently passed, and Larry Bell. And these, because it's so difficult to experience a light and space work through documentation, through a photograph, we're introducing the broader public to the phenomenology of light and space art at an airport. So the message also encourages artists working in this medium moving forward to work in environmental and sustainable materials. So hopefully it's a message that can represent California. It represents Southern California, this one now, but generally the Bay Area seems to be our passion.
Yeah. Fantastic. Well, you know, I'd like to thank both of you, Laura and Narin, for all your great work, and we look forward to hearing more and seeing more from you. Jim Newman, such a great honor and such a pleasure to have you with us tonight. This was such a treat. It really means a lot to us.
Thank you.
And thank I want to thank
everybody. Thank you so much, Peter.
That was such a pleasure. And thank you all in the audience for joining us. As always, you help complete the circle. I want to remind everybody, I've posted links with which you may purchase the book in the chat function. Also links to learn more about Label Curatorial. Tonight's event has been made possible by support from the City Lights Foundation, continuing the legacy of our founder, the late Lawrence Ferlinghetti, through public events like this one, our publishing program, and educational outreach, all dedicated to sustaining a vibrant community of readers, writers, and independent thinkers. So take care, everybody. We hope to see you all again soon. Be well.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you. It was wonderful to be here and share with you all. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.